you have your copy of God's Word, and I pray that you do, I'd invite you to open to the book of Acts, chapter 1. If you're using a Black Pew Bible, it's on page 909. And as I say every week, if you do not own a Bible, that Black Pew Bible is your Bible to keep. You can take it home for real. It's a gift from Oak Grove Baptist Church. We just ask that you read it and obey it. How many of you know what this is? A surge protector. Yeah. Last service, some people were yelling out, power strips. It's a surge protector, and it's the job of a surge protector to protect our appliances from severe damage that can even burn our house down in the event of a power surge. Now, a power surge is a brief electrical excess of power that can only last 1/1000th of a second, but it can fry a refrigerator or an air conditioner, or it can destroy your computer instantly. Surge protectors absorb any excess energy and sends it into a grounding wire where it decimates the additional power. Now, physically and financially, a power surge can be destructive and dangerous. But I believe spiritually, in the lives of Christians, it's exactly what we need in our churches and in our individual lives. And I'll tell you why. There was a recent survey of over 1,000 Christ followers, and they were asked this question: how many of you believe that you are living your Christian life to the fullest? The answer was 11%. Now, that means that 9 out of 10 believers are basically wandering in the wilderness. It doesn't mean that they're not saved. They know God, and they love Jesus. God is in all of them, but all of them is not necessarily in God. Now, it's estimated there's 2.56 billion Christians in the world. That's roughly 1/3 of the earth's population. And if these numbers are true, the 9 out of 10, that means that 2 billion Christians are not exercising anywhere near the spiritual horsepower that is available to them. Stop and think about what would happen if every day of our lives we experienced a power surge of the Holy Spirit. Imagine what the church would look like. Imagine what the world around us would look like. See, I believe that our problem is not a power surge, it's surge protectors. I believe that as Christians, we set up too many surge protectors in our lives that keep us from fully experiencing the power of God through the Holy Spirit of God. We're either too busy, or we're uncommitted, or we're just apathetic, or we can't bother to come out of our comfort zone. When we read about the early church in the book of Acts, it's not too much to ask the question, what happened? What happened? How does a group of people who are financially nobodies because they had no money, politically they had no power, numerically they were a teeny tiny little piece of the population, how did this little ragtag bunch of people turn the world on its head? We're in our final week of our VBS series, Spark Studios. Over the last 5 weeks, we've looked at God's creative hand in creation, his design, and how David praised him, Jesus as Redeemer, Jesus as risen Savior. And today, we're going to be looking at how God empowers us through the most neglected member of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. This early church was ordinary people, fishermen, farmers, shepherds, but they were willing to bear witness to anybody who would listen to them. And they did it without buildings and without budgets and without bands. They were a bunch of nobodies telling everybody about somebody. And this church experienced tremendous growth and tremendous power. And what was the difference? What did they have that we don't? Nothing. The same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is the same power that fell upon these apostles. It is the same power that you received from God the day that you repented of your sins and turned to Christ Jesus for salvation. That same power that moved these men to move the world is the same power that lives inside of you. You see, this book of Acts is actually a two-volume set. Volume 1 is the Gospel of Luke, which tells us about the founder of the church. The book of Acts, which the King James Version calls the Actions of the Apostles. I like that much better. because the apostles didn't just sit around and talk about evangelism with one another. They didn't just sit around and study the Bible. They went out and told people. They lived the Bible. The book of Acts is about the founding of the church. Now, the way that they found their secret, it was in the power of God, that God empowered them by the Holy Spirit. The book of Acts talks more about the Holy Spirit than any other book in the Bible. The Holy Spirit is mentioned 50 times in the book of Acts, and one of the major symbols of the Holy Spirit in the New Testament is fire. And so when we go through the book of Acts, we read how Christianity spreads like a wildfire all over the world. We're going to be taking a look at that this morning. We're going to be camped out in the book of Acts, chapter 1 and chapter 2. So you put your thumb in there. It's on page 909 of your Black Pew Bible. It is on your screen. And if you're able, I'd invite you to stand for the reading of the Word of God. Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse 6. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in each other's tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is this that we are hearing each of us in our own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we bow before you humbly this morning, grateful that we can boldly approach your throne of grace through the shed blood of your Son, Jesus. God, we thank you for Christ's sacrificial death, his vicarious death for us on the cross, paying a penalty that we incurred, a penalty that we couldn't afford, a penalty that we could never pay back, by giving us the mercy and the grace that we don't deserve. God, we thank you that the tomb could not hold him, death could not keep him, but he rose victoriously. And God, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit that abides and lives inside of each and every one of your children. I pray now that your Spirit will flow freely among us, that we will feel his presence not only in our hearts, but in this very room as we worship together and seek to lift your name high. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. John the Baptist said in Matthew chapter 3, verse 11, speaking of Jesus, said, "I baptize you with water for repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire." The reason that this early church was so different is because it was made up of people that God had empowered with the spark of the Holy Spirit. He had set their hearts and their lives on fire. And as a result, the world literally was set on fire. Someone once said, "If we are not going to move this world by criticism of it, nor conformity to it, but by the combustion within it of lives ignited by the Spirit of God." We have everything today, everything we need to be empowered for God's service. We have everything that the early church had to be everything that the early church was. With three things the scripture tells us, we have a duty to fulfill. Luke tells us that Jesus, raised from the dead, spends 40 days with his disciples. Now, they're not sure what their next move is going to be. And Jesus tells them that their next move is to wait. Now, I don't know about you, but that's one thing I have a hard time doing. I have a 3-year-old daughter. and that word wait is the bane of her existence, because she wants everything now. And I gotta give her credit, because she got it honest, because her daddy's that way. I like drive-thrus, and if it takes longer than 10 minutes at the drive-thru, I'm, wait, what's going on here? Did you forget about me? The disciples are told to wait. That is not what they were expecting. They were expecting Jesus to say, go. See, what they don't know is that he is about to ascend into heaven. So they say to him in verse 6, when they had come together, they said, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. Jesus rebukes them here. In other words, he's saying, mind your own business. Your job is to do the work that I'm getting ready to equip you to do. My job is to restore the kingdom. You see, they thought that the kingdom, they're thinking worldly terms here. They're thinking that it's a military. They're thinking that it's a political or a territorial kingdom. Jesus sidesteps their question, and he tells them this promise, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. That great commission. That is the mission that God has called us to. That is the duty that we are to fulfill. That's the work that we are to perform. That word witness means martyr. Now, when we think of the word martyr, we think of somebody who dies for their faith. But back then, originally, the meaning was someone who just bears witness to his faith. Someone who speaks about what they have seen and what they had heard and what they had experienced. Now, remember, these disciples are talking to the resurrected Jesus. Their faith is standing right in front of them. They put their fingers in the nail prints in his hand. They could stick their fingers in the spear mark in his side. These people had seen him. They had experienced him, raised from the dead. All Jesus is asking them to do is simply to bear witness to what they had seen. Just tell them what you've experienced. That's it. And that's all Jesus requests of us today. If you have a testimony, then go out and testify. If you are a witness for Christ, then go out and witness. And it doesn't have to be fireworks. You don't have to have a road to Damascus conversion. You just have to have a conversion. Who you were before you met Jesus, how you came to know Christ, and the difference that he's made in your life. You can do that in 3 to 5 minutes. It's really, really easy. Be a witness for Christ. But there's two things you have to keep in mind about a witness. One, you can experience something and not testify to it. In other words, you can keep your mouth shut. You can commit the sin of omission by not sharing Jesus. Or you can bear witness to something that you've not experienced. Ten Commandments talks about that. It's called lying. When you say you experience something that you know you haven't experienced. In other words, you can either refuse to testify about the Jesus that you know, or you can tell a story about the Jesus that you don't know. But those are the only two options. Because if you have experienced Christ Jesus, you would want to go out and tell people about how he has changed your life, how he has changed the eternal trajectory of your life, and maybe even the lives of your spouse, maybe the lives of your children, maybe the lives of your legacy, because that's what Jesus does. See, what this early church did, we're still celebrating that today, because they were faithful in sharing the word, because they were faithful witnesses. Now, Jesus didn't say, you might, or you could, or you should be my witnesses. He says, you will be my witnesses. He is predicting success. He tells us then where the witness would go. First, he tells us to go into our Jerusalem, which is our family and our friends and our neighbors. He tells us to go to our Judea, which is our communities, our counties and states. And then finally, Samaria, the other countries and cultures that are all around us. Now, was Jesus right here? Well, in the 20th century, Christianity became a global religion. It became a global movement. In fact, today it's growing exponentially in Africa, Asia, and South America. If we want to be a church that's empowered by the Holy Spirit, we have a duty to fulfill. Second, we have a dynamic power to use. Now, Jesus has given the disciples their marching orders. They know exactly what they are to do, and they know where they are to do it. But as I said before, Jesus doesn't say, go and work. He says, go and wait. And for 10 days, that's what they do. And then we come to Acts chapter 2. So if you have your finger in your Bible, turn to Acts chapter 2. See, Acts chapter 2 is the delivery room where the church is getting ready to be born. Acts chapter 2 is the reason that every other chapter in the New Testament follows. Acts chapter 2 is a turning point in the history of God's kingdom, because the disciples have been given a plan to carry the gospel into all the world, and now they're going to be empowered to carry out that plan. And it's not a political power, it's not a military power, it is a supernatural power that comes from heaven. See, because the kingdom of God grows differently. It's spread by witnesses, not by soldiers. It's through a gospel of peace, not a declaration of war, by the work of the Holy Spirit, and not by bombs or bullets. Because God does everything differently. And that's what the disciples couldn't understand. They were thinking worldly. And Jesus is saying, I do things differently. I'm God. He's going to give them supernatural power. Now listen, we have to note how the Spirit came and what happened after he did. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there was a dwelling in Jerusalem. There was dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed, and they were astonished, saying, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Now listen, on this day something happened that had never happened before. The Holy Spirit came, and he stayed. Throughout the Bible, there are instances where the Holy Spirit would fill a person for a specific purpose, for God's plan, and then he would go away. But now he is permanently setting up residence in people's hearts. Two things happened on the birthday of the church. First one was a miracle, and the miracle was everybody heard the gospel in their own language. Pentecost was one of the three major festivals on the Jewish calendar. People from all over the known world at the time would come to this festival. There were 14 different languages represented, different languages, different dialects, and the language that the people spoke was the language that they heard the gospel in. Now, what's the point of this miracle? Well, the point is it's God's way of telling the world that the message of Jesus Christ is for everybody. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter how much of a scoundrel you think you are. I'm the chief of sinners, said Paul, says Jim. Jesus takes us just as we are, but he doesn't leave us that way. Amen. I have talks with people in the community all around, and I say, you should come to church, and I try to share the gospel. You don't know who I am. You don't know how bad I am. And I say, you don't know how good of a God Jesus is. You don't know how good of a Savior he is. You don't know how much mercy and grace and how his grace abounds. Where your sin abounds, his grace abounds even more. Jesus catches his fish before he cleans them. When the day I got saved, that old hymn, Just As I Am, was being sung. And that's how I came. But I'm going to tell you something. I didn't leave that day just as I was. I left changed because I had experienced the power of Jesus Christ. Listen, everyone is welcome. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. And these people from all these different regions, all these different languages and dialects, heard the gospel in their own language. Now listen, I think it's interesting that Luke reports that these were Galileans, because I've told you before, Galileans were the Appalachian Americans of the first century. They were the hillbillies. And I can say that because I am one, so I fit right in with them. Galilee was kind of like Mayberry. These were the country folk, uneducated folk even. It would be kind of the equivalent of Cy Robertson, Uncle Cy, showing up at an event and speaking perfect Mandarin Chinese to someone and sharing the gospel. Now, Uncle Si struggles with English. So wouldn't it be a miracle? Wouldn't you be amazed and astonished if Uncle Si suddenly started speaking Mandarin Chinese? But that's exactly what happened here. Now many folks will say, well, wait a minute now. You speaking in tongues, a lot of times people will speak gibberish and say they're speaking in tongues. That is not biblical tongues. The word glossolalia for tongues in Scripture, it talks about known languages. Now, when you speak in tongues biblically, you are to do it for the edification of the church, and there is to be an interpreter around. It's to build up the church. That's what all the signs and wonders that God gave us were for. It's not just simple utterances. It has a meaning. It's not just a heavenly language. It's a known language. Listen, 90 years ago, this church is getting ready to celebrate our 90th anniversary, if the Lord tarries, in October. When this church was founded, it was founded on the vision that everyone that came in these doors would feel welcome. And every single week we see that fulfilled. That vision comes true every single week, because we don't care what nationality you are, we don't care what skin color you are, we don't care where you've been, and we don't care where you're going, as long as you're going to heaven. You are welcome here, because we are to take the gospel to everybody, because the gospel is for everybody. And that's something that started 2,000 years ago, and it continues on today. Now, that was the miracle. The milestone was this. In Acts 2:11, it says that everybody was speaking and was talking about the mighty works of God. In other words, everyone was witnessing. They weren't talking about the chariot races. And they weren't talking about the gladiator games. They were talking about the gospel of Jesus Christ, because the Holy Spirit empowered them to do the work of God. And that's what he does to us today. He empowers us to do work that we cannot do in our flesh. And that's what's so beautiful about it. Because God can take someone who, like Moses, well, Lord, I can't speak good. Listen, you just go and you let me worry about that. Or Gideon, oh, I'm the least of my clan, and my clan is the least of the tribes. Just go. You have faith. I'm going to empower you to do the work. And that's what God always does. There are more than 7,100 known languages in the world today, and God wants Jesus Christ to be proclaimed in every single one of them. If you're in Christ, then the Spirit is in you, and Jesus will come out of you. We have a dynamic power inside of us. Third, we have a declaration to proclaim. Now, beginning in verse 14 of chapter 2, Peter begins preaching the first sermon in the history of the church. This is the grand opening of the one institution on earth that will never shut down. It will never be defeated. It is always going to be permanent. The church of Jesus Christ is going to live forever. Jesus said even the gates of hell would not prevail against the church. That what was born on the day of Pentecost is going to last forever. And that same message that Peter preached on that day is the same unchanging message that we preach today. In Acts chapter 21, it began, Acts chapter 2, verse 21. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know this. Jesus was delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. Amen. If you have a hard time sharing the gospel, read that right there. Acts chapter 2, verse 21 through 24. Because Peter touches on all of the great theological themes here. He talks about the incarnation, that Jesus was a man. He, albeit the God-man, the sinless man, Jesus was flesh and bone. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, John 1:14. He talks about the crucifixion, that it was God's plan, but it was carried out by sinful men. And then he talks about the crowning jewel, the resurrection. Acts 2:36, let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Amen. The resurrection is a crowning proof that Jesus is more than just a man. He is the He is the Messiah that was promised in the Old Testament. He is the Lord of the universe. See, from the very beginning, the church was never to be built around simply on the teachings, and the miracle, or the life, or the death of Jesus. The church was built based upon the resurrection of Christ Jesus. That was the church's main message then, and it's to be the church's main message now. Peter spends one verse talking about the incarnation. He spends one verse talking about the crucifixion, and then he spends nine verses talking about the resurrection. He's talking to both Jew and Gentile, and he says to the Jews, you believe in God, but you're looking for a Messiah. Look no further. His name is Jesus. He says to the Gentiles, you're not looking for a Messiah, but you're looking for God. Look no further. His name is Jesus. See, Jesus' resurrection is far more than just life after death. To the Jews, it was proof of his messiahship. And to the Gentiles, it was proof of his lordship. Now, Peter and the witnesses are all excited by one thing, and that is that Jesus has been raised from the dead. Now, listen to how the crowd responds. And this is how some of you all might need to respond today. Now, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Now, I don't know that Peter was a Baptist, but I'm just saying. What do you think that this minister, this preacher, this anointed and empowered man by the Holy Spirit, brother, what should we do? What did he say? Attend church regularly. Give weekly. Get religion. Eat more chicken. Now, here's what he said. This is what he said and what every preacher and every pulpit should say every single Sunday. And Peter said to them, verse 38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. What a promise. Thank you, Jesus. See, that word repent means to turn. He is asking them to change their mind about who Jesus is, to turn from their sins and to turn to him as the risen Lord. What will they get in return? Peter tells us two things. You'll get the forgiveness of sin and you will get the gift of the Holy Spirit. Because when we receive Christ as Savior, we get freedom from what we used to be and we get the power to be what God wants us to be. Amen. Now we hear the first altar call then in verse 40. And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. And they did what every follower of Jesus Christ is expected to do after they say yes to Jesus and they receive the Holy Spirit. They are to get baptized. Now, this is a great time for detractors to say, wait a minute, hold on. Jesus is dead. I'm going to take you to his tomb. I'm going to present the body to you, and this whole thing is going to be over and done with right here and right now. But no Pharisee stood up, no Sadducee stood up, and no skeptic spoke up. You know why? Because he's risen. Because he's alive. Because they couldn't. You know, what does this say to the church? It says that the church was never meant to be localized in a building or centralized into a denomination. It was meant to be energized around one event, and that is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You know, if there's one name that is well known outside of politics and music and arts, it would be the name of Billy Graham. I think just about everybody that's alive right now would know something about Billy Graham if you're more than about 10 years old. Back when Billy first began his ministry, he was going to go into a town and he was going to preach one of his revivals. And the town commissioners, they all got together, and they said, you know, we don't really want him to come. We don't like the fact that he preaches about sin, the fact that he calls people to repentance. They just didn't like the message. And somebody said, if we let that man come to our city and preach, he's going to set the church back 50 years. Well, that quote got to Dr. Graham, who smiled and said, I don't want to set the church back 50 years. I want to set it back 2,000 years. Amen. You see, 2,000 years later, we have the same duty, we have the same declaration to proclaim, and we have the same dynamic power that the early church had. Because Jesus Christ is alive, and since the Holy Spirit is here, we ought to be on fire for the Lord, empowered by the Spirit. My prayer is that the Lord would set me on fire, would set this church on fire, and let our light burn just as bright and as hot as it did 2,000 years ago. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we give you praise and thanks for who you are. We thank you, Lord, that we can boldly tell people that we serve a risen Savior and not a dead man, because that tomb is empty. We thank you, Father, for the great commission that you have given to us. And we thank you especially for the fact that it is a co-mission. You didn't simply just tell us to go out and do a job. You said that we were going to do it alongside of you. And Father, as you fill us with your Spirit, we know that Spirit never leaves us. He is our closest friend. He is our God who convicts us when we sin, who offers compassion when we hurt, who dries our tears when we're aching and experiencing sorrow, who illuminates us to your word and enlightens us to the truths of Scripture. God, I pray for those here today who may be part of that 9 out of 10 group that really isn't truly experiencing their calling. They're not really experiencing and utilizing the power that lives inside of them. They're like people who walk around with their car keys in their pockets and push their car from town to town. All they have to do is turn that key, and all the power in the world will be released to them to do your will. Father, I pray for those here today who don't know you as Savior. They've never repented of their sin. They've never turned from them and turned to Jesus and asked for forgiveness. But Lord, your word says that when we do that, we receive the forgiveness of sin and the precious gift of the Holy Spirit of God. Lord, I pray that during this time of invitation, that the Spirit would do what only the Spirit can do, that he would convict sinners who are far from you, drive them to the cross, to the only one who can save them, Christ Jesus. And it's in his name I pray. Amen. If the Spirit of the Lord is speaking to you, and you would like to ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins, the Bible says he's faithful and just. He will do just that. He will cleanse you of all of your iniquity, all of your sin, all of your transgressions. He desires for you to come to him. The only thing we can bring to Jesus is our sin, but he says, gladly bring it. Lay it at the cross. Let me deal with it, and let me send you away washed and filled with the Spirit. Maybe you need to be baptized. Maybe you'd like to join our church, or maybe you would like someone to just pray with you today. Whatever your need, whatever the Spirit's prompting you, please come during this time of invitation.